Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Madison. Thank you for all the Facebook Live viewers for tuning in tonight's conversation. I'm very excited, and we're all here in the Doyle building. We're excited. We have our masks, we have our hand sanitizer. I'm like super excited to be welcoming Dr. Jenkins here to our district. So Dr. Jenkins is the first of our two superintendent finalists. He's going to be coming to talk with us and to also answer some questions. So my name is Ananda Murili. I'm one of the Madison Metropolitan School Board members, and I'm going to serve as our tonight partner in that conversation. I'm going to be also serving as a moderator in our Q&A session that is going to happen right after our discussion. So before I introduce Dr. Jenkins and let him talk a little bit more about himself, I want to take a moment to talk about how tonight's sessions are going to work. So we'll start by having Dr. Jenkins tell us a little bit about himself. Then we're going to move into the Q&A session. And you can write your comments right where the comment sections are. And then behind the scenes, we have amazing staff that are going to be logging those questions and making sure that I can see them. And they're going to be grouping those questions as it relates to the candidate profile that our community helped us design. I'm going to be reading those questions then to Dr. Jenkins to respond. And then I'm going to ask Dr. Jenkins to be as succinct as possible in order for us to get a really good representation of the many questions that our communities have. So we're going to keep the answers to 2 to 3 minutes. And Dr. Jenkins, if you go a little bit over, I'm just going to give you a little gentle nudge
Okay.
so we can get
Okay.
things
All
going.
right. Okay.
Leslie, we'd love to get your feedback on what you're hearing, what's coming up for you. So after the session, again, we're going to be cataloging all the comments and reviewing all the comments. After the session, you can also go to mmsd.org/Jenkins, and that's JenKins. And then we are asking for you to submit your feedback. Now, the deadline is short, so we are asking for you to submit your feedback by Thursday, July 2nd at 11 a.m. That's just in a couple of days, Thursday, July 2nd by 11 a.m. And we know that it's a tight turnaround, but we are hoping to move forward with our decision as quickly as possible. I know our community is also really anxious to get this decision underway, and we'd like to have your feedback and hear from you all as we're making this decision. Wow, this is a lot, y'all, but I'm really excited to be here with y'all. And let's get this started. So, without further delay, I'm so pleased to turn it over to Dr. Jenkins.
Hello, Madison. I'm Carlton Jenkins. I'm a candidate here for the superintendent position, and I'm very glad to be back home. And I say home because this is where I started my administrative career in 1993. I was at Madison Memorial High School. I went to UW-Madison and received my master's degree after coming from Mississippi Valley State University, a historical Black college university. And then while I was here in Madison, I continued and finished my doctorate degree here as well in the educational leadership and policy analysis. My career has taken me from Beloit, Wisconsin to Madison, Wisconsin, and back to Beloit. And from Beloit, I had an opportunity to go on and become a high school principal after having served there as a middle school principal and assistant principal. And then I went on to be a superintendent in Saginaw, Michigan, where I had a great time in Saginaw. And then I was recruited to Atlanta as the chief academic officer prior to coming to my current role now as superintendent of Robbinsdale Area Schools. And in the last 5 years, we've been having a lot of fun in the Twin Cities. I have not even began to think about another district, but then when Madison came and individuals from the community asked me to look at it, I was like, hey, this is going home. And so I'm very excited to be here tonight and have an opportunity to speak to all of you.
That's excellent, Dr. Jenkins. And I can see already we have a few questions. So are we ready to start? Thank you so much for the bio, Dr. Jenkins. So, one of the first questions, and then this is something that Madison feel really strong about, and every time there is an issue coming up around charter schools, people have a lot of opinions. So what is your take? How do you feel about charter schools?
Well, there are public charters and there are non-public charters. And my career, I've had an opportunity to serve in districts that have had primarily public schools, but been in a large district like Atlanta, we had a mix of charter schools and public schools. It is my idea of trying to create the best educational opportunities for our children possible. I personally believe that the greatest opportunity for us to serve our children would be within the birth to 12 public schools. But I know that some individuals have interest because of their children or just their personal beliefs. And so I would like to have conversations with those individuals before or as they're trying to partake in a charter school to see where they're coming from. But I've seen it from both perspectives, but I am a strong proponent of public schools, but I have had conversations before with individuals in charter schools.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jenkins. So you talked a little bit about, the holistic student experience. Can you talk a little bit about your take on reading and reading strategies? You probably have seen Madison have struggled with that for quite a number of years and made headlines at a lot of times. So can you talk to us a little bit about what's your take on reading strategies and what are you thinking about, particularly in Madison? What are some of the things that we can do here?
Well, as I looked at the data here in Madison, there is some serious gaps between our students who are of color and their white peers. And when we talk about reading in the nation right now, we're having some issues with reading as we have moved between this whole of direct teachers and then also a focus on phonics. And so the fact that we are losing ground in terms of reading is what we're teaching, how we're teaching and understanding the science of being able to teach reading. And it's really critical that we give the appropriate professional development. In most universities right now, staff are only having one methods course in how to teach reading. We have to gauge into the research that talks about the science of being able to teach students how to read fundamentally and looking at how students spell, how they read, and just from a phonological standpoint, we need to know that. And also we need to introduce students, particularly students of color, to culturally relevant materials to assist them with seeing themselves within the literature as we, within the curriculum, as we're trying to help them teach. And we have to start very early, even with our parents in the community, and make literacy something big within our community, because we know that literacy also influences students' numeracy.
Let's stay on the topic of literacy. And I'm going to read this question because it's coming from one of our teen editors at Simpson Street Free Press. So this is our local free press that is run and edited by a lot of young people, a lot of our students here in Madison. So here's what the student is asking. Recently, Alan Page, Neil Charkery, others in Minnesota have been pushing a constitutional amendment that would establish basic literacy as a fundamental right for all students in Minnesota. Do you support this amendment, and do you consider basic literacy a fundamental right enshrined in our country's constitution?
You are breaking up, but if I could repeat, I thought I heard you say that reading is a fundamental right.
So let me just repeat the last part of the question. So there are students in Minnesota that they are pushing for a constitutional amendment that would establish basic literacy as a fundamental right for all students in Minnesota. Do you support this amendment, and do you consider basic literacy a fundamental right enshrined in our country's constitution?
Well, let me say this, and without having read the amendment that you are alluding to, I do wholeheartedly believe that literacy itself is a fundamental right, and that we should be pushing that all children are able to read, because it's just a gateway to everything else that you're going to do. Yes, it is. Just as education is a fundamental right to me, but with education, you have to be able to have the literacy piece in it. But I can't speak to the amendment because I don't know that particular amendment that's being pushed forward.
I'm really sure you're going to get an email with all that pretty soon. So thank you so much for answering that. Dr. Jenkins, can we talk a little bit about the unions, your relationship with the unions, and what are some of the successes that you have seen as you're, you know, collaborating with unions?
I have had great success in working with unions, and I know this, it's important for everyone in education to come together to be able to work in the interest of our children. We have some things that are historical in terms of challenges in education, and we have to come together to try to resolve some of these issues. If you bring in the union, if they come in and you sit down and you're talking about our ultimate goal, it should be about learning. And but unions are there to also represent the rights of the adults, and I support that as well. But I've had a positive working relationship with the unions everywhere I've been, in Beloit, in fact, where I started my teaching career. Madeline Shar was like a mentor to me. She was the head of the union when I went into administration. I kept a great relationship with her. And when I was in Saginaw, which is a strong, Saginaw, Michigan, strong union town, I worked collaboratively with the union to help move our district forward, to help work not only move an achievement, but to also keep us fiscally responsible. And right now, I have a great working relationship in the Twin Cities in Robbinsdale with our union president, as he too comes in. And one of his big things is reading as well. So if you have a collaborative working relationship, it's in the best interest of everyone, for our students and our adults in our community.
Thank you so much. So you start touching base a little bit about your background, some schools that you have led and you have worked. Can you talk to us a little bit about your experiencing, in particular around closing the opportunity gap that we are experiencing here in Madison, and how those things translate here to Madison?
Yeah, and I think I'll go back to Saginaw. One of the things that we had when we had a gap in our mathematics, and one of the things that we did close the gap, but we also closed it some with the literacy piece. What I have historically done is gone into districts that were vulnerable, that had gaps, who had financial challenges. That was my calling, to be able to go do that and to work and find some of the best practices around what would it take to actually eliminate those gaps. And so we saw success there. When you look at my resume, the various things on there around graduation rates in Saginaw, you'll see the same thing in terms of increasing graduation rates, 15%+. When you go to Robbinsdale right now, we have increased our graduation rate each year for the last 4 years now in Robbinsdale. But you have to be very intentional. It doesn't matter where you are. And some places are going to have more resources than others. But whatever resources you have, you're going to have to work together to align those. And you can't do this work without also engaging staff heavily in the work and laying the plan out. I've had what you call a graduation plan. And in the graduation plan, it brings together all of the staff. And it's constant communication to the parents about where the students are. It's bringing the students in, listening to the students, and giving them voice as well.
Thank you so much. So I wanted to shift gears and talk a little bit more about students. And in particular, my question is going to be around LGBTQ students. So if you can share with us, so Madison is a very LGBTQ friendly city. Can you talk to us a little bit about how have you shown your support for LGBTQ students with LGBTQ staff and families? And how did that show up in your past careers? And what are you currently working on in your district?
Well, first of all, I think all students are students, and you have to recognize them for who they are. And I think all individual staff, they have choices. And I have always said all means all. And so individual choices of my of our students, of our staff, I think we embrace that within our entire family. And I also advocate that everyone does. And we will not tolerate anything less than that from students harassing, bullying. That's a pet peeve of mine, and harassment. And we should create every opportunity so that all students can feel a part of the learning community. One of the things that we do know, when students don't feel a part of it, they suffer socio-emotionally and mentally. So in my current district, we've had to address, as everyone has in the country, about transgender. We had a situation where our student we gave out a diploma with both identities that the student chose. They wanted it to represent both of their identities, and so we did that, and it was no problem for us. And I advocate for students in my student group meetings. I meet with students lunchtime buddy meetings at the high schools, the middle schools, and we talk to students about being who they are, where they are, and we encourage them to go to the counselors are talking to other adults, and we also work with our adults and making sure that we know that everyone is free in our environment. I would like to say that our district and our community in the Twin Cities, very open as well to all of our students.
Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. And I'm sorry, I think we are having students some difficulty with the audio, and maybe it wasn't as clear. But I wanted to go back because you started out the answering the supporting LGBTQ students and staff and families with a word that is an interesting word of choice. And I just wanted to kind of get back to that. Like, what exactly you mean by student's choice or family's choice?
Well, basically, students can identify however they choose to identify. We don't tell students what they are. Parents have a right with their own children. And sometimes you'll see that a child may identify in a school one way. If a parent get in a conversation and say, hey, this is what my child, how my child should identify, that's a parent-child conversation that they do need to have. But when it comes to us in terms of how a child identify relative to their non-gender or gender, that is, that's what I mean when I say it's a choice. We don't try to determine that, and we just let it go with however the child and the parent comes to us. And we have this as early as kindergarten happening right now in our district, and we work with the child, we work with the families to make sure that those child are in a safe learning environment. Mm.
Thank you. So let's talk about English learners. I actually have a daughter who attended schools in Madison. She's a junior this year, and she's a senior because the years are already turned. And she identifies as an English learner. So what are some of the two pressing educational challenges that you know, students that are coming in, they're emerging in English, they're learning English, or they're learning multiple languages at home? What are the challenges for the district to be serving those students, and how do you plan to address those challenges? Go ahead, Dr. Jenkins.
Well, it's a challenge that we see across the country, actually. But here, when you look in the data in Madison, and we start thinking about our students who are performing at a particular level, the early introduction, the earlier that a student gets introduced to multiple languages. And then fundamentally going back to what we talked about with literacy, there has to be a strong biliteracy program for the student early on to assist the student. But when students get up to the high school level, it's not to say that those students cannot still persist in high school. And we have to work with our ELL staff. We have to also bring together with our curricular staff, our general curricular staff, to make sure that those students are being exposed to grade level expectations, and then at the same time getting support for their language acquisition.
Thank you. So let's move to students that qualify for special education services. And Madison is one of the districts that have disproportionality. What is your approach to IEPs and 504 services in evaluations for students? What are some of the recommendations to teachers and administrators? And then how are you supporting, what's your plan to support the teachers and the staff that support those students?
Well, first of all, I will come in and I will look at the plan that we currently have in place. And though we do have disproportionalities, that is too in a number of places where you may see special needs students not performing as well. We have to ask ourselves why. And what kind of resources have we organized around it? And the resources are not just money resources, but time resources. And how much of those special needs students also in inclusionary environments? And are they also given the right support? Are we giving the staff the right support in terms of how to differentiate for those students who are receiving special needs services? And then it's a combination of working with the family and consistent communication. We can't have just the expectation beyond the student or the staff or the parent. But we have to make sure that we approach this as a true team effort. And really what we see in terms of best practices for students in special ed, it also works for students in other areas. And so I would just say paying close attention, putting students who are receiving the services in clearly general ed, grade level expectation courses with the appropriate support from the other staff as well. It's not just a special ed problem, it's a general ed problem as well.
Thank you so much for that. And I just want to say you're doing extremely well in answering torpedo questions. I appreciate how you're timing yourself because the questions keep coming.
So thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, of course. Viewers are just joining us. They can just write questions in the comments. And we have staff that are working in the background, making sure that I'm getting all the questions. And they keep coming. So advanced learners, what are your experience in having and ensuring that those students get access to appropriate advanced learning programs? And how have you addressed challenges in the past?
Yeah, and just so you know that you're breaking up a little bit when you ask me the question. So if I missed something in it, if you could just, and I'll clarify what it meant. But I thought I heard you ask about advanced learners and how have I addressed it and ensure that students get in their advanced courses?
Yes. How did you address some of the challenges for advanced learners? And what is your plan for supporting those students in Madison?
Well, I tell you, the plan here in Madison, first of all, I take from the recommendations of looking at the OCR report that came out about Madison and how students are getting into the advanced level courses, and how we identify students for advanced is very important, and it shouldn't matter. And then two, once they get into advanced or get into our regular courses, how do we make sure that the regular courses are high quality, grade level expectations, and students who may not have been identified initially may have even been performing below, but you can see the potential in them, those students, and then could place them into advanced learning. In my former setting, and even in our current setting right now, we're looking at how do we go about exposing all students to high quality level of instruction. And here in Madison, I think right now we're running about 79 to 80% students at the high school level who are in advanced courses. And I'm looking at the students who are in advanced courses, but I'm also looking at the elementary literacy and numeracy and seeing how students are performing and trying to see how we have changed to have an advanced learning K through 8 specialist looking to try to get some level of articulation. A student going just directly into the advanced learning and we don't have the appropriate resources to support them is not in the best interest of students. So we have to come back and revisit our resources to make sure that every student who wants the opportunity that we can support them in ways so that they can be successful. I don't believe it's just putting a kid there and then not giving them the appropriate support for it. But if I have a desire to be in it, I may be below grade level, but then it's up to us as a staff to look at how we allocate resources to support those students so we can break down some of those historical systemic races barriers that don't allow all children to have advanced learning. And I will say this to you, algebra is not advanced. I tell parents that everywhere that I go, they think that just putting a kid in algebra, that's advanced. That's not so.
So I'm gonna use your final ending of your answer to connect with our next question is, what are your plans to address systemic racism in the district?
Well, I tell you this, one thing looking at Madison, and just knowing Madison's always been in the forefront of a number of things. We have our society right now that's dealing with the murder, the lynching of Mr. George Floyd that just took place recently that has caused a lot of racial tension and civic unrest. And I think that we have to take that head on. It would be my intent to address that because right now we have not only Madison, not only the state of Wisconsin, but we have the nation and the world all in a very vulnerable place right now. And until we can address that fully and deal with how we are running our schools and thinking about our schools in a very anti-racist fashion, then we're going to continue to have some of the tension that we have right now. So my goal would be to come in, see what's already happening. And I know that there are things already happening in terms of professional development for some staff, and then work with the senior leadership team, work with the board, and then engage the community. This is a community conversation. This isn't just a school conversation.
Thank you. So I'm going to tag in another question that it's coming here from our Facebook Live. As you know, my colleagues and myself just voted to end the contract with the security resource officers, the SROs. What is your take? So you're going to be coming in to, you know, having to address this, you know, what you know, the aftermath of a vote that you weren't here to witness, but it's very much in the minds of a lot of our residents. What are some of the strategies and some of the things that you wanted to have in place as school resumes in the hybrid format or whatever format is coming in September?
Well, first of all, I think that's something that we all have to address, and that's not just a school issue, that's a community issue as well. And we need to start off by pulling individuals to the table and talking about how we began some of our social justice programs and think about some restorative practices where we can work with our students, work with our staff, and work with our community, in that now we don't have the school resource officers in schools. We have to ask the question, did they actually need to be there in the first place? Mm. How did we get there to that point where we thought we needed resource officers in schools? And now that we don't have the resource officer, what's the plan? Mm-hmm. Everything that you look at right now in the literature is talking about the increased socio-emotional and mental health issues that we're having. We have individuals that we can learn from around the country, around the state, who are addressing this issue as well. And I think we have to come together and put our best minds together and say, how can we stop this disproportionality that had been taking place with just some of the trauma of some students seeing officers in the schools, and then it's impacting them from a socio-emotional. That's a real conversation that we're going to have in the district and in the community, and then try to still reach out and work with our police in the communities and individuals who are about safety in our community, because this is a community issue as well. And we still have to work and try to have best relationship for everyone and not just look at just a police being bad. No, we have to address the real issue, which is institutional, long history of institutional racism that has taken place in our country.
Mm. Thank you so much for connecting both answers and then also talking about the social emotional learning. So my former colleague, Gail Ford, is asking specifically, what will you do to ensure Black student success?
Yeah, and that's one, let me tell you, in the strategic framework, I looked at that and I was very impressed the fact that you had in there for goal three in Madison. It calls out Black students and other youth will excel. But it was intentional to put Black students first because of the historical challenges that we know that we have throughout our country. And we have to be willing to call it out, be unapologetic about saying we need to work with all students, but realize that there are some students, not only Black students, but if you look at the data, the Latinx students, there are challenges. There are special needs students with challenges, but specifically, we do have to call out the whole idea of Black students and what's going on. Let's deal with Madison. Let's look at Madison historically. Remember, I was here in 93. Mm-hmm. We had challenges then, we have challenges now. So it's time to address it. And we need to bring in community partners who have even a better historical context. We need to get our staff together and we have to do professional development around that. How do, when we say all and excellence for all, what does that mean? And how do we take it from a racial standpoint to ensure the success of our African-American children? And knowing the data disproportionately shows that we have a challenge in that area across the country.
Yeah, thank you so much. So I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about the budget. What differences that you see connected with, you know, your experience in former school districts, and how do you see connected with the Madison School District and our, regarding to our budget? And if you can talk a little bit about the current challenges that we're experiencing, right? So we have complications in our state budget. We don't know yet what is going to be our budgetary allocation. And so you're going to be coming in with that and also a referenda and the horizon. Can you talk a little bit about what are some of your previous experience that you see transferring to the experience in Madison? What's your take on all those things that you're going to be coming into once if you get this position?
Well, I think I bring quite a bit of K through 12, pre-K through 12 experience to the table, in particular around the area of finances. When I was in Saginaw, Michigan, I went into a district knowing that it had it was going into a significant deficit. The deficit was around $33 million when I went into the district. And what we had to do as a team, as a board, as a community, based upon the guidance we had been given from the state in terms of rectifying our budget, we had to put the plan together. We put together a plan to eliminate that deficit and did. And right now, Saginaw is running just a little bit over 20%, I think, in the fund balance. But we had to look line item by line item and see. We had two charges. How do we become fiscally responsible and yet still improve academics at the same time? So we had to make an intentional decision to try to stay away from the classroom as much as possible. But when you're talking about making that level of cuts, you do impact the classrooms as well. Looking at Robbinsdale, where I am now, when I went into the district, historically, according to Ballotpedia, since 1992 to 2013, the budget we had been spending over the allocated amount by $7 million. And so when I went in, the board was trying to be very responsible. And they said, hey, we know that we need to balance our budget. And we know that we were also very similar to here in Madison, talk about the potential of a referendum. But we knew based on a report that we had been given by Baker Tilly that we need to create more efficiencies within our organization before we go to the taxpayers. And that's my belief. You have to create the efficiencies, make sure that you're not wasting any money before you go back out to the taxpayers. Long or the short, we did. We started trimming our budget, doing budgetary strategic realignment. And as such, when we had a referendum on the table, it passed with 62%. And we didn't just do a renewal. We asked the voters for an increase, but we went out into the community. We talked about what were our challenges historically, what we wanted to see happen for our children in terms of providing high quality education. And I tell you, I'm in a wonderful place. They believe in education. The voters came through, 62% pass rate on an increase in a referendum. Now, once you do that, you can't stop. We're having to continue to go line item by line item, making sure that we're in line with our budget. And we have a team, as a team, senior leadership team. We all sit, the board has given us the charge. We work with our staffs to make sure that we're trying to balance the budget and we put it in the right direction. Now, I'll tell you this, when you do tough stuff like that, you do get called from some people thinking that maybe you're overspending money. I just had an investigation that came up. The state auditor came in, looked at our budget, based upon a few citizens had gotten together and filed a complaint saying that we were doing something with the money. When you're trying to be fiscally responsible, you should give people the opportunity. And we offered up several times, please come in and look at our books, bring your best accountants. And when the state auditor reported, she said there were no findings of wrongdoing. But what we had done, we made a tough decision to balance our books, spend within the resources that we have been given. And we've also increased the graduation rates the last 4 years at the same time.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jenkins. I'm hearing an echo now. All right, it went away. All right, so a COVID / safety question. Should this pandemic continue or another one occur during your tenure, what would be your approach to keeping our children safe while delivering face-to-face, hands-on instruction? And then how are we going to ensure that they are actually learning effectively?
Well, first of all, when we had the COVID-19 to occur in my current district, we were the first district in the state to close because of COVID-19. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's a tough decision, but based upon the evidence in the health community, it was a necessary call. And I often would like to remind people that this is a health situation. It's bigger than just our academic situation. We have to make sure that you're safe first. As much as we as human beings, and I miss the students, I miss the staff, we're all missing one another. We have to make sure that you're safe. Right now in the country, you probably noticed that 36 states have also just recently reported a spike in their cases. We don't want to put our students, our staff, our parents, and our community in a situation because we have come to love some of our traditional experiences. We don't want to put their health at risk. Sure, I would love to have us back, all the students back in schools. That's a part of what we really love. But if it's not safe, then we have to take on other alternatives, which may mean now not doing distance learning, because we learned a lot from distance learning. We have to move towards online learning, but students become agents of their own learning. And as we begin to guide and we plan differently, that was a reaction to something that happened. Now we're foreseeing and forecasting that we may be in it longer. So the online learning now should be a better quality than what it was when we were in distance learning. Mm. And I'm sorry too. And what we also know from online learning or what we did in distance learning, our students who are the most vulnerable are the ones who got harmed the most. So we have a lot of work to do in that area to try to ensure the quality of learning continues here at Madison.
Mm. Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. Can you talk a little bit about recruitment and retention of staff of color? What are some of the strategies that you have used that have been successful? What is your plan here for Madison? And specifically, given that, you know, we are in the middle of negotiations with an employment handbook, we have definitely not been, we've been really represented in the media in regards to, you know, our ability or perhaps our missteps in regards to communication with the union. And what is your vision here for Madison?
Well, I'll tell you, I'm hearing feedback. Can you hear me? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. My vision here in Madison is to take, first of all, to sit down, take the opportunity to sit down with the current senior leadership staff, sit down with the board members, and sit down with the union and talk about it. What is it that we're trying to achieve? And then we have to be realistic. We know that things can't happen unless we really want it to happen. Within the literature, it talks about the impact of a child having one person that looks like them in their schooling experience. We have to understand the value of adding diversity in our workforce. And we have to know this, we can't go out and recruit staff of color and then they're the first ones to be laid off. So we have to create provisions so that we can retain individuals once we bring them in based upon what we're saying we want to happen. In our core values in Madison, we said belonging, right? We talk about racial and social justice. We have to ask ourselves, are we putting those big words out there in our core values and do we mean it? Well, the question earlier talked about African-American children. We have to look at Latinx children. We have to look within special needs and we have to bring in quality staff, and then we have to do whatever we can to support them being here. So the handbook, what was happening in terms between the administration and MTI, we would have to come back and revisit that discussion. If we're going to be serious about it, we have to have the discussion. And I've realized it's a process. Things aren't just an event, but we have to start, first of all, with putting it on the table in the community. We have to involve the community. Where are they with this discussion?
Thank you. So you mentioned Latinx students and Native American students. How do you see them as part of included in our Black excellence strategy?
Well, I think in goal three, it says African American and other youth excel. That's what it says in the goal. And other youth means to me, we're talking about all. And I think when you look at the data around our Native American students, our Latinx students, if we're truly trying to be about our core value of excellence, how can you move forward without talking about the Native American students and the Latinx students and the special needs students? How can you move forward? And that would be my constant question to all of us. We're Madison. We can do this. We can do better. We do not have to sit here in this country and have the types of gaps we have. Nicole Alexander from the University of Minnesota talks about our budget reflects, right, what we value. And so we have to come together and have a community conversation on this. How do we transform our community? This is a matter of just courage and will meeting at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Can you share with us some examples? So here in Madison, we have a large population of Hmong students that their data gets conflated with Asian students' data. We also, one in every four students is Latinx. And we have, you know, quite a number of Native American students that represent our student demographics. What are some of the particular strategies that you have used or you plan to use here in Madison to ensure that, you know, that they are also visible, that they are also part of the conversation when we are addressing racial equity in Madison?
Well, the conversation has started before I even got here, but I think I'm going to definitely be willing to join in the conversation to ensure that all students, because I think in our in the goal of Madison, goal one, it talks about keeping students on track, ready to graduate, right, from high school, prepare for college and careers in the community. I think that was visionary to talk about in community. What does that mean in community? We want people to be positive contributors within our community. So that means all the students that we're talking about, we do have to look at a data point for our Hmong students in the middle schools when we start talking about literacy. Mm-hmm. We talk about the African-American children, but right behind them are the Hmong children. And that's of a different Asian persuasion, different challenges. And when we start talking about socioeconomics, that gets into it as well in terms of not the child's ability, in terms of our belief systems. I think that we could talk about systemic racism and anti-racist practices, but we know too, within the education system, we have got to address this whole idea of expectations about children who come from poverty. I'm a kid who came from poverty. My dad had a third grade education. My mother had a 10th grade education, very much like a number of children, but they had the expectations and I had great teachers. Our teachers are our greatest assets. But we have to give them the appropriate training and build the appropriate culture so that all children can excel. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so not only Black children, but it says Black and other youth shall excel. Unless I'm missing something when I say other youth, I think everybody's in that group.
Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. You touched a little bit on that on your answer, but can you talk a little bit more about your strategy around partnerships?
Oh, yes. I think one of the things that I would want to do coming in here, having graduated from the U myself, I would like to leverage those resources. Right now, we're doing it in special ed and a couple other places, but we have the number one public institution in the country right here, not in our backyard. I say to people, not in the front, they're right here. We are them, they are us. And we need to take advantages of some of those great minds and strategies and practices and having them looking in and working side by side with us. As I've looked at the data and looked at some of the staff that we have here, we have wonderful staff. We have to engage. Then we also have to go outside of the university types and go into community and talk to our parents. Talk to our parents and talk to other groups. We have to have affinity group meetings about what's the real experience of individuals in our community who are parents, okay? And some of our parents who are out there who are thriving, doing very well professionally, and the children our children are not performing as well as they should as their white peer counterpart. And then even looking at the white children, when I looked at the data, there are white children not performing as well as they should be performing. So really we have an issue where we have to go back fundamentally early on, talking about literacy, talking about numeracy, talking about expectation, and what do we need to do to remove barriers together. But this is a community conversation. A school system, in my experience, has been it transforms when we can take the school and put it in the community and the community into the schools.
Thank you. So what are your thoughts on around staff development? You can talk a little bit about if you have experience with grow your own programs previously. We also have that here in Madison. What other development that you foresee for staff as you are coming in? You know, you'll be coming in with like very lofty like goals and a lot of plans to actualize.
Yeah, well, let me make sure I heard that question, because I heard you say something about grow your own and then I heard you about professional development. Which one was it?
Yeah, so staff development. So if you wanted to talk about from inception of growing your own into, you know, becoming a staff, current staff, developing current staff to match with some of the goals that you have for Madison.
Okay, and if that's the goal in terms of recruiting and retaining staff of color, you're exactly right. And I did say earlier in a conversation that I do believe that you have to grow your own students. And currently in Robbinsdale School District, we are growing. We have growing your own grants that we have been able to receive. And we have some effort out of our HR department that's really trying to look at how we grow our own staff, too, who may be EAs in our buildings, who may have other positions that are non-teacher positions. I also talked about once we get individuals in the district, they not only need to be in positions of teaching, being a counselor, a psychologist, we need to have a career path. If individuals want to matriculate into administration, or if individuals want to go into the curriculum department, we need individuals represented throughout the organization. So we need to have a concerted effort of how do we continue. Right now, there's a partnership in Madison where we're looking at building our own teachers and helping it out with the tier licensure that we have here now. I just believe that we need to work to try to expand that.
Thank you so much for that answer. So can we talk a little bit more about accountability? And also, how does accountability looks like? What is accountability looks like for you, Dr. Jenkins? And if you can talk a little bit more also about strategies to make sure that there is a good synergy between central office and schools in order to achieve some of the goals that you would be that you plan for Madison.
Well, first of all, I think there are a number of wonderful things already in place, and I would want to come in and hear from the individuals here. What are those things that are going exceptionally well? Then what are those things not going well? Mm-hmm. We start off by listening to one another, and then we set some real specific goals about what we need to do to obtain this whole better support that I believe that you have to give to your staff. But what we think from one level of administration and what staff may think of support or principals may think, we have to just have a conversation. We start everything with looking at what's the current plan, how we have the conversation, how we're going to organize people around it, how do we communicate it out, and then what decisions that need to be made. And then I would use some of my past experience of being able to have great influence with principals, the great influence that I could have working with teachers and working with unions and everyone being a collaborator and moving that forward. There is, and I have read up on the ascension that you alluded to in terms of lack thereof feeling supported. I have to ask the question, why? And once we sit down, I'm sure that we can come together and figure out why the barriers are there and we can work together. You have to have a healthy teaching staff, mm-hmm. and we have to feel supported. And then you have to have principals feeling healthy. Maybe it's coming out of my office. I'm sending the wrong message, but I have to be willing to sit and listen to individuals. And sometimes I have to pivot from how maybe how I'm approaching something.
Mm-hmm. How would you support staff through both development or professional learning, and in particular about implementing the rollout of the plans, the English learner plan or the behavior education plan or the special education plan or advanced learner plan? How are you intended to support staff?
Well, there are some plans already in place. When you start talking about the behavior plan, which we were cited for a disproportionality there, and so there had to be a response. And if you look at the ESSA report and it talks about some of the things that we plan to do, when I first walk in, I just want to listen, hear people out as to why they have made some changes and put these particular plans in place. I don't think that I could walk in and just throw the plans out. That would not be prudent on my part to do that. I want to come in and listen to people, work with them, because as you just mentioned earlier in the question, in terms about the dissension, which leads to morale issues, if individuals don't feel valued, then their work productivity decreases. So, but you help individuals feel valued by coming in, listening to them, seriously listening to them, and putting an action plan in place. And then when you start getting the results, it kind of increases the morale for everyone.
Hmm. Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. So you mentioned ESSA. We also are still having the effects of the No Child Left Behind. And we have a pretty extensive cadre of standardized testing. What is your vision? What is your take? What is your opinion on those accountability measurements? And how do you intend to support the staff and support the district moving forward?
You kind of broke up in a couple of places. If you're not
repeating that. I'm realizing that here in Doyle, I don't know if there's many people connected right now, and Doyle's like, no, this is too many people here. There was a question regarding, you mentioned ESSA. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there was a question regarding what is your take on ESSA, No Child Left Behind, and standardized testing that we are implementing in our schools? What is your take on that, and what's your vision moving forward?
Well, I think, one, our reality, I'm going to take the last one first. Our reality, you mentioned standardized testing, right? The reality, that's a part of what we have right now in public education, the standardized testing. I don't think that that should drive what we do about learning, but we do know that this is the world we have right now. We have standardized tests. I do believe in that you should assess students for their learning. But I think that we need to work collaboratively and talk about how do we have students achieve grade level expectations and what assessments are we going to have in place. The standardized tests are there. We don't control that right now, but they should just be the minimum, the standardized tests. It shouldn't be the end goal for us. If we're teaching high quality, grade level instruction, then our students should have no issue hitting proficiency. But are our staff getting the right level of professional development to be able to differentiate as we would hope and expect? Are our students and our parents, are students coming to us in a way, and are we communicating with our parents regularly enough so that can happen? Let me just start with that first. Secondly, in terms of ESSA, you mentioned, and you could tell me, I think you said No Child Left Behind, right? What did you say? Yeah, that was it. So with ESSA, I think when there are some things that are disproportionate, and if individual school districts get cited, I think being cited is, first of all, no outside agency should come in and cite you for the work that you're not doing. We should already have accountability systems in place before that happened to make sure that we're trying to show progress. We shouldn't just respond to the OCR or someone coming in and saying, now we're going to do all of this. Mm-hmm. My question is always, well, why didn't we do it before then? So But I do think there needs to be some degree of accountability, not some degree, there needs to be accountability for our children learning and for what we're doing as educators. In terms of No Child Left Behind, you know, another unfunded mandate, and I can say a whole lot about that because a lot of these mandates are unfunded, but the reality of it is we came into this profession to make a difference, make sure we're educating all of our children, and we should be setting clear, high benchmarks for our students, and we should be monitoring that progress, and we should be communicating with the students and the parents in the community in terms of how we're performing.
Thank you, Dr. Jenkins. Let's talk a little bit about students that are experiencing homelessness. What has been your experience in the past, and what are some of the strategies that you like to see happening here in Madison?
Well, I tell you, I've always been involved with county level committees where we're dealing with homelessness and foster care. And here in Madison, I see that there's already some collaborative programs going on to try to address. And with COVID-19, there is some intentionality behind our students who are homeless and what we're trying to do here in Madison. And I think that from my experience in working on those types of committees and understanding how the resource changing with the McKinney-Vento resources, along with there are some other resources within the community to assist our homeless students in understanding the homeless students' issues are bigger than academic. This is where we have a lot of socio-emotional, mental health situations taking place. And so when I talked about the whole child earlier, this is a part of the whole child. So we should align our resources to try to support our children who are homeless and support their parents and communicate with their parents and let them know that we see them and we're here to serve them and support them as well.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. You started mentioning community engagement. Can you talk a little bit more about what is your take on family and community engagement? So I'm going to say this, Dr. Jenkins, the chat does not stop. It's amazing. It's beautiful to see the level of engagement of our community to making sure that they're voicing their concerns. We're not going to be able to answer all the questions here between that and what the staff is sharing here with me. There's a lot of questions. So this is this is not lacking engagement.
And that's exciting. It's exciting to have a community that want to raise questions. And I think we ought to look at if I'm the one selected coming in, there would be community engagement opportunities. There's so many things that we haven't been able to get to, from the ELL to the special ed to the African-American children. For real, you started going into when you mentioned Hmong children and Latinx children. And it's a lot of things to talk about. And it's great to have a community that's willing to engage in dialogue.
Yeah. So can you talk a little bit more about the community engagement and the family engagement and family partnership? What would you like to see?
Well, first of all, to engage family, I would first come in and see what strategies do we already have to engage families. This is where our trust issues happen. When we don't reach out to parents, and as I was reading one of the reports in the ESSA, in the plan it was talking about with special needs and with ELL. And we noticed too with other families, the communication back from us as a school district, sometimes being 6-7 weeks, that's serious. If I'm a parent and I'm trusting you, and a lot of our parents do, they blindly trust us. So we're gonna have to repair some trust. And so in engaging parents, we can't call meetings here at the central office all the time and say, hey, I'm having a meeting. No, we have to go to the community centers. We have to go out into our schools and the neighborhoods and start engaging parents in a process. Go out and do our World Cafe conversations. And then we just can't go out and have the conversations. We have to come back after hearing from our community and begin to put action plans in place. A courageous conversation with no action is a waste of time for everyone.
Thank you so much for that answer. I can see that folks are responding to some of your comments. Let's talk a little bit about students that are multilingual and double immersion schools or language immersion schools that we have here in Madison. In Madison, our families, we have families speaking over 100 different languages. Mm-hmm. So what is your take on dual language programs or immersion programs, and what have been your experience around schools or school districts that offer those types of programming?
We actually have in Robbinsdale one of the best Spanish immersion schools around, and there is an appetite for Spanish immersion, but there is also an appetite for dual immersion. So as such, when we were looking at our district and trying to have the respect that we have for languages and the appetite that some parents wanted to be in a dual language experience, we just recently, 2 years now, started a dual language program. Both programs depend upon the intent for the parents and the students in terms of that type of learning. Within the literature, it talks about immersion, and it also talks about dual. In dual, native speakers, in terms of parents, would like for their children to have a 50-50 type of approach of learning. And even in the immersion, you have to have a biliteracy approach, and you have to do that early on, because we have children being exposed to Spanish who are non-native speakers or who are native speakers, and they can't read. I'm going back to the early investment, which I said we have to make sure that we understand how to teach our children the science behind teaching reading. So even if it's in a dual immersion or Spanish immersion, it's going to be critical that we're given the appropriate professional development so that our children can get the biliteracy in the early grades, and then they can go on and thrive as bilingual, or they can go ahead and thrive in terms of just an immersion program.
Thank you so much for that answer, Dr. Jenkins. Can you talk a little bit about also what does it look like? What is your experience working with undocumented students and family? In Madison, we have a lot of families that have mixed documentations as well. What is your experience, and how do you make sure that their voices been also heard, that they are taken into consideration as you rolling out different plans and supports? The question is around, so for folks of you that know, we are in two separate rooms, but they're in the same internet. There is some lagging in the internet. So thank you everyone for bear with us. So the question is around undocumented students and families. Mm. So what has been your experience, and then how do you plan to support the families and the students here in Madison?
Well, my entire career, I've been in situations where I've had undocumented students. I've had the pleasure of working with our DACA students, and when the students come within the school systems, we have to know that we have to communicate with those families differently, because some are too afraid of what may happen if their whereabouts or the fact that it comes out that they're undocumented. We're working with the students and we're working with the families. And I think in coming into Madison, we would have to see first, I would have to see what's the current plan. Because if students come through our doors, we have to educate our students. You can't educate the students if you're not going to attempt to communicate with the parents. And I don't think it's just the responsibility of our ELL department to mm-hmm. do it. We have to find ways to connect with our parents outside of just asking them to come here for a meeting in the central office. Mm-hmm. So again, we have to be creative in terms of how we do the family engagement piece to make sure that those families who have that situation are feeling very supported. And mm-hmm. many times you have undocumented parents, but you have children who were born right here in America. So they have their citizenship. And our goal, end goal, must be to try to support our children.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jenkins. So we're almost at our time, and I have two more questions for you. Some folks are asking about curriculum. So we have heard from folks like really making sure that our curriculum is both honoring the diversity of our district, also it has a high level of rigor, but students are feeling engaged and connected to that curriculum. And then if you can talk a little bit about the curriculum, but it's specifically in the context of now virtual learning, which it's likely that we're going to be in this mode for a while, at least for the upcoming year.
Did I hear you correctly saying we were talking about curriculum, but and how individuals don't see themselves reflected in a curriculum?
Yes, a curriculum that reflects them. And then if you can talk, in particular, the challenge around virtual learning.
Right. Well, this is what I would say. First of all, I want to just come in and see what's the plan already, right? Because this has been a big discussion, not only just here in Madison, but all over. We have to have a textbook or whichever means of a curriculum that we're going to choose to use, because the textbook isn't the curriculum itself. But whichever means we're going to use, this is where we really have to lean on, bring our teachers in, bring parents in, bring students in, and give everyone an opportunity. When we're looking through our textbook adoption, and I'm going to use textbook for the purposes of this, or our curriculum adoption, to say, to have an opportunity to view it before we adopt anything. And I think when we talk about involving the community, this is a meaningful way to involve the community. The days of just bringing, nothing against cupcakes and chocolate chip cookies, because I like that, right? But we need to engage our community in meaningful ways as to how they want their children to experience learning in our district. This will go a long ways in terms of trying to reestablish some trust. I've done my homework. I do know that it's some trust building that's going to have to happen here. And as saying that, I know that coming in, and let's put it out there, either one of us, myself or Dr. Kelly, be the first African-American. And coming in as an African-American male, let's put it out there. We know what that means. And I'm saying to you, I'm willing to come in and do my part, and the community have to do their part. And we got to remove whatever you think you see and stay focused on our children. And the real issue is, like, how do we get to the point where they can see themselves reflected in the curriculum that we're teaching? Mm. And if we can do that as adults, take the focus off us, put it back on the children, we could come out with a fabulous curriculum that supports what our staff, what they're trying to do for our children.
Mm. Thank you so much, Dr. Jenkins. So this is a really good segue to our formal last question from the public. And I'm going to give you some minutes for a few minutes for you to wrap up our conversation today. It fits really well. I almost like, oh, did you know I was going to ask you this? So this question is coming from someone that I consider a colleague in this work and a friend, Kaleem Kerr. And so he asked, because you would be Madison's first Black superintendent and a male, history shows that Madison will place an enormous amount of expectation on your shoulders that they never place on the shoulders of your predecessors, which is a little bit about what you're talking about, particularly addressing our challenges with Black students. How would you deal with this pressure, and how can our community help you deal with this stress?
Well, I appreciate the question, but that's my reality in 54 years. The blatant murder of George Floyd was my life played out in 8 minutes and 46 seconds. Hmm. That was a lynching that occurs in the CEO room, as a superintendent, as the owner of a company, and it's time for that to stop. So how can you support? I think we all need to become a part of a conversation and talking about human decency. And if this conversation is about education, let's let it be about education. Let's let it be about educating all of our children. I'm not going to shy away from it because that's my reality right now in terms of that additional pressure. Shouldn't be because of that acceptance that this is the way that it is, that it have to be. That itself, we don't even know, but we become immune to those types of pressures, and it causes socio-emotional issues, causes health issues. Mm-hmm. Not just for me, because our children will look to me as an African-American male, and they're going to watch you as their parents, how you treat me. And it's going to impact them in some kind of way. So I would say to the individual who asked that question, let's be a part of it. Be a part of the solution right now. Let's put that out there. What would it mean? And how can we resolve this? I can't do anything about how someone's going to see me and don't want to do anything about how they're totally going to see me. I will come at you every day as an African-American male. You need to know that. And for whatever narrative you've been given about that, you need to try to understand human decency is bigger than whatever narrative you've been given. You recognize that you have a superintendent coming to you that went to school, graduated, doubled out of Madison with a winning dissertation that's been around the country, making positive contributions to children's lives, and would want to come back to Madison to continue to make great contributions. I want you to tell that story, and the individual who brings that up in a negative, then you can send them to me. I'll be happy to engage with them. But that's what I would say to you. Sorry for the long answer, but that was a powerful question. Thank you. I want to thank you for that.
Yeah, thank you. So tonight we talked about challenges for different students. We talked about different programs that Madison offers, different strategies. We talked about budget. We talked about staff. We talked about, we covered a lot in a less than an hour that we've been here. And I know that it was a little bit challenging with some of the technical issues. The microphone here is not picking up everything. And but I really appreciate you, Dr. Jenkins, your answer. I really appreciate the engagement in the chat. It's been nonstop and all the questions. But I want to give you a few minutes, Dr. Jenkins, for you to wrap us up and talk to Madison. Tell them like why they should choose you as our next superintendent.
Well, I tell you this, and I would just say to the public, please know the other candidate is a fine candidate. I did my homework on her as well. And I think when you talk about choosing me as a candidate, things I want you to consider, first of all, I'm coming home. And my career, when I left out of here, I'll never forget leaving UW-Madison and Dr. Jackson, who was my advisor, and told me, he asked me a question, what was going to be my contribution? And to go out and do something with this education that I have been afforded. And I'll never forget that. And I've been going around the Midwest, even spent a year down in Atlanta and trying to go on out and make a difference. I'm in a fabulous situation right now in a wonderful community. And I have not taken any opportunities to interview for any other job. But when Madison came calling, and individuals from the community came calling, and they've also looked at the work that I've done to make a difference for children, and they had a conversation with me, and I looked deeply into Madison. I say, this is a place that you would have a superintendent, if you select me, that comes here unapologetically, knowing and loving Madison. I am a Badger through and through. I'm here for our children. The children that you talk about, the most vulnerable, that's me. Mm. My mother had a 10th grade education. My father had a 3rd grade education. And somewhere I was probably undiagnosed as someone who's special needs, as most of us are. Mm. But you know, it's possible. I want you to look at me and look at the children who you're seeing right now having those gaps and know that it's possible. It's possible. And if it can happen anywhere of eliminating those gaps, it should happen in Madison. We have the top university. Why can't we have the top district? I want to thank you for having me here today. Whatever happens, Madison needs to move forward. It's time.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jenkins, for this heartfelt ending for our conversation. I wanted to share with you my immense gratitude for you to spending the day with us, specifically during this pandemic time, for repeating the answers multiple times, because I know you met with different groups. And I know that those questions came up several times, and it's almost 9 o'clock and you're still here and answering with so much passion. So thank you, Dr. Jenkins.
I want
to take a moment to thank our community who, you know, is writing all sort of comments. I know I called folks out by name and they were calling each other and acknowledging that, you know, they're here to support our Madison district. All the questions were very well thought out, very compelling, and folks have stayed with us this entire time and really engaged. So if you missed the beginning of this call, of this live stream, pretty soon it's going to be recorded and on our Facebook, so you can go back and see it. It's also going to be on our YouTube channel. But one thing is really important. We're the board members are going to be reviewing comments and feedback on for Dr. Jenkins, and you can leave those comments at our website www.mmsd.org/Jenkins, J-E-N-K-I-N-S. I'll make sure to put that on my Facebook as well, so folks know where to go to leave comments or feedback, anything that you have heard. Or, you know, if there's, you know, other questions that you have, so then we have that the opportunity to review that. Our community will have until Thursday by 11 a.m. To give that feedback. So thank you again, Dr. Jenkins, for joining us this evening and for staying with us day in the district. And I wanted to remind everyone that we're going to be live here tomorrow on Facebook with Dr. Carol Kelly. Thank you, everyone, and have a great rest of your evening.
Okay, thank you. Thank you guys for having me here. It's been wonderful.
Thank you. Is that it?